All right, I'm back. I think it's because everybody and their nap. There we go. People are coming. Hi, Mary. Go back to my page and then try again. Refresh it. Hi, Stephen. You okay? Yep, I'm good. Long time. Right, let's see. I've seen you now. Ah, it still says unable. What's going on? Can you request to come in? Because usually when you go on someone's live, you have to... You can usually ask people to... Why? It's working for everyone else. Hold on, let me see. No. I don't think... I think maybe it's your settings or mindset. It can't be my... I'm just going to try with someone. Mary, do you mind? You don't need to be on camera. I just want to see whether it works. This is so annoying. And the thing is, it comes up that everyone else can go live with me, but you? Yeah, unless the only other option is for me to go live with you. So if you go live and then I come and join, because it won't let me... Hello, Mary?
Hi, Toby. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, but I can't see you.
Can you see me?
Mm-mm.
Hold on.
Oh, technical something.
Yeah, I think there is a technical issue, though, because I can't even see myself.
Yeah. You know what's funny? I go live all the time and it's never a problem.
Exactly. Now, like, the devil is a liar. I was really ready for this, right? I was like ready for this. Yeah.
Yes, Santi. Are you using your laptop or your phone? I'm using my phone.
Okay, so you can go live on
your
laptop then,
can you? No.
Okay, maybe that's
the app. Okay, hold on. Okay. All right, then.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, then, no problem. Hey, everyone. Oh, showing everything again. Hello. Hey, it's working. Wow. I was really getting scared. Okay. Yeah. It wasn't there. Listen, okay. Technology is not an easy thing. It really isn't. It really isn't. Honestly, instead of it to be clear that you can't do it.
Exactly.
Hey. Hello.
Okay, right.
Can you see me at all? Is it bright enough?
I can see you. You might want to go somewhere that is got a little bit more light, but I can see you fine. If anyone else says in the comments that they can't really see you, then I guess try and see if you can find a bit of light, but I can see you. It's okay.
Okay.
You and...
Well, this is my first time of trying this, yes. So...
Oh,
technology.
I'm so glad it's with me. Do you know how many people have tried this live first time with me? So many people. They're like, I've never done this before. So, okay. So, everybody, today, as I've put on my story, I'm going to be speaking with OIF Nigeria, the founder, the CEO, the... the Hevretwin, the machine, the well-oiled machine that is my lovely, lovely friend here. So first of all, I want you to just tell people what's your name and explain what you do and who you are and what is OIF Nigeria.
Okay, thank you so much, Toby. Yes, my name is Tarella Ganti. I'm a mother of three, and my second son, Steven, is got brittle bone condition, type 3. And he's here. Steven, say hello.
Hello.
We can see your face. I can see your face. Say hello.
Hello.
That's it. Hi.
Hello. I'm over here.
How are you?
Fine, thank you.
So do you want to tell everybody how old you are?
Well, wait, hold up.
You're 16.
I'm 16, going on to 17.
Yeah.
I was about to say I'm 17, going.
Yeah. He's
16. Yeah.
Yeah, and
my name's
you want to know my age?
You don't have to. It's up to you.
No problem. I'm 48. I'm 47 years old.
She doesn't look it. Imagine. Look at.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. So OIF basically is, as the name implies, OI does. Osteogenesis Imperfecta Foundation Nigeria, and basically osteogenesis just means brittle bone condition. Yeah, and I had to start up the foundation because of my son Steven, and my experience that I had in Nigeria, because I had him in Nigeria, not in the UK. The experience that I had in Nigeria was really very awful. There is no awareness at all. I didn't know about the condition, and my family we've never heard about it before. Mm. And when I had Steven, through his pregnancy and then birth, and when we had him, we didn't know anything about it. We had to, you know, go through the trauma and the pain and the stress all alone, in darkness, really, because we didn't have any idea what was actually wrong with him and what was wrong with, you know, with him. He was just crying all through. And finally, after 3 years of the whole stress and pain and having multiple fractures, we finally came down to England to have treatment. And then since then, a few years after, I saw, because I was attending the Brittle Bone Conference regularly, and I saw lots of colored people. So I just felt there must be, you know, if there are so many colored people having this same condition, then I'm wondering what's happening back home. I never had the opportunity of meeting anybody in Nigeria that had the condition.
Yeah,
the doctors couldn't really tell me what was wrong with my precious baby when I had him. True. And so I just thought, you know, I really do need to go back home and, you know, create and raise awareness on this condition, Because from my experience, I realized that after having Stephen, because of the lack of knowledge and lack of understanding by the professionals and by the public, we were kind of, there was a lot of trauma. And there was this, it's like a taboo having a child with disability. Having a child with, you know, broken bones all the time. And, you know, it was really very, very strange and very troubling. So I thought, you know, it would be great to really go back and raise awareness and support other children and families that have got this condition, you know, to help them pass through, you know, the stage where I was in Nigeria. So, yeah, I had to go back and set it up. So that was why I went back to Nigeria and set it up. Yeah.
Wow. Okay. That's amazing. What year again was that? Just so that everybody is clear.
Yeah, I started OIF Nigeria in 2016. I had to go back and then I started the campaign, went on to live TV and radio stations, and we just started the campaign from there. And in 2017, it was finally registered with the CSE. And it was registered with the CSE. So OIF Nigeria is a registered charity organization in Nigeria with the CSE. Yeah. And since then, we've been operating. Yeah.
Perfect. And after this live as well, I want to work out how we can set up that people can donate to OIF Nigeria, because I think that that is really important. The Brittle Bone Society do come up, and OIF comes up as well. So we've got to get that definitely going, because I wanted to refer to it yesterday, which was Wishbone Day, International Wishbone Day. Hooray! And that was, you know, amazing, because we're celebrating and wearing yellow, and it was great.
I'm still wearing my yellow.
Yes. She's still sporting an amazing top that I actually asked her if she doesn't mind to show. That's the logo of OIF Nigeria and the foundation and everything. Please make sure after this live you go over and have a look at this awesome, awesome woman's page and her foundation, because it means so much to me personally, because my own mother went through the same thing, the same story, and that is often the case with a lot of mothers and fathers that are bringing up children with OI. So my next question to you is, when and why did OIF Nigeria start? So you've already kind of answered that now. Oh, everybody's celebrating the NHS.
Yes,
I can hear them. Okay, let me go on to the next question. All that clapping made me get rid of the questions. Oh no. No, where's it gone? Oh dear. If it's not one thing, it's another. Okay, you know what? I'll be back. Sorry about that. I'm back. So what services does OIFN offer to people, and who is it for?
We do quite a lot, really. What services we offer, number one thing we do is to raise awareness. it is very important to raise awareness, especially in Nigeria, being a country where you know, a lot of people do suffer a lot, you know, from the condition, especially with stigmatization and lack of knowledge. We are dealing with people's beliefs. From my experience, when I had Stephen, because people didn't know understand and they didn't know anything about brittle bone condition, it's like a taboo to have children with disability. So, and there is that, you know, that belief with the people that people with disability, especially with, you know, having a child with OI that breaks all the time, they tend to spiritualize things. And then they tell you that the child is being bewitched, or you are from your child is evil. So we had to you know, try and break through that barrier and sort those kind of problems out. So we raise a lot of awareness, because that will also help families to be accepted in their family. And within the wider families, and then will be accepted into society. Because some areas, when you have children with disability, they tend to abandon not just the child but the mother also. Those are the things that I'm finding that we're seeing through experience that are happening with members in the organization right now. The mothers are being segregated and abandoned with the child. So we're dealing with that kind of issues, and then we are raising awareness to that so that there can be acceptance, and then we connect patients together, people that are living with this brittle bone condition. We connect them together, because sometimes it can be so isolating. You feel like you are the only one in the whole world that is suffering from this kind of issue or disability that is not even well known. And we need to also understand that brittle bone is a very rare condition. So, you know,
not regular to see this everywhere across Nigeria or the world in general.
Exactly. So, you know, helping them to connect with each other, then they can, you know, they can, in that way, they can have a family again, and then be able to relay, you know, experiences together, just interact with each other, and just lean on each other, really. And then we connect our doctors together, because we've got quite a few doctors that are working with the organization right now. And we connect them together so that they can, you know, learn more from each other. And we also connect our local doctors with our international doctors, the experts in the field.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, so we connect them together so that they can, you know, I remember when we started Zoladronic in Nigeria. We had to connect our doctors with the UK doctors. So,
and
to
for
help
those
them
who don't know what Zoladronic might be, could you just explain a little bit what that is? Is it
is it medication?
Is it something that's expensive, and what, you know, what's it for?
Zoladronic. When anybody that has got brittle bone condition, they are placed on what is called bisphosphonate medication. Now, in this bisphosphonate medication, we've got quite a bit, really. But the most common amongst all of it is you either use the pamidronate or you use the zoladronic. And these medications are medications that have been given intravenously to help to strengthen the bone of the child or of the individual. And also it helps to reduce pain in that individual. So with the pamidronate, you take it every 6 months, every 3 months. And then with the zoladronic, the person has to take it every 6 months.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So we've spoken a bit about why it's like the kind of people that you kind of target. Is there an age limit for those who might be looking back at this? Maybe they might be worried that they're not, you know, old enough or young enough. So is there an age bracket within this society, or is it for everybody?
No, there is no age bracket, because brittle bone it can be hereditary, and so it is very possible for you to find children with brittle bone condition, because it has to do with the collagen in the child. That means when the child is being formed in the womb, if the collagen is not strong enough, the protein in the collagen is not strong enough, or is not there at all, then that's affects the gene in the child and makes the allows the child to become to have brittle bone as they are being born. So there is no age limit. There's no age bracket. We have people that have children that have brittle bone in the organization, and we also have adults. So because they grow, and with brittle bone, you have different types. So with the type one, some of them might not even know they have brittle bone at all, not until they get to a certain age in adulthood before they begin to see symptoms and begin to realize that they have brittle bone. And some of them, especially with the type three or type two, that are born with it, and you begin to see symptoms straight away. Like for my experience with Steven, I noticed something wasn't right even while I was pregnant with him, because the pregnancy wasn't really growing, because he is my second, and I've gone through having a child before, and so I had my first, and the difference in the growth in the bump, I could tell. And the way I felt during the pregnancy, I could tell. But unfortunately, because I was in Nigeria, it wasn't detected at all. And we couldn't really start off treatment before then. So, now that I'm well knowledgeable about it, that we are creating the awareness and then speaking to our doctors and, supporting our doctors also to be able to detect this condition early enough. So we support children, we support adults, and we just so that they can get early intervention and early treatment to help them in life.
That's great, because I, from my experience, I didn't get treatment until very late in life, and so it's only now as an adult from probably the age of 18 upwards that I've kind of taken control of my own health. So it's interesting that even funny enough, even though I was born here, I still had some of the stigmas and the issues because of the fact that I come from a black home, because I come from a cultural home that is Nigerian, and my mum was not aware. And also, back in 1992, showing my age, it was just very, very confusing for my mum. She didn't really know anything. And so a foundation like this would have really helped her, to be honest, exactly. To have somebody to support her. So it's fantastic that this is here. So
it's interesting that you really mentioned that, your experience, and especially coming from a black minority background. I think the issue that we go through, our parents go through, and me being a parent to Steven, the issue that we go through is completely different. And because of the stigmatization, because of the taboo nature of the way they tag things and their beliefs, so it's really something that needs to be looked at and identified and tackled in a very sensitive way, so that we can get a headway and make positive changes to that.
It's a way of trying to, as you said, like changing the culture and the way of thinking everywhere for particular groups of people, such as, let's say, West Africans, or to be honest, even my friends who are Indians, they go through the same thing of that taboo and that sort of, issue, whether they're living in England or whether they're living abroad. Hold on, I've skipped a few questions. So where can people find you?
Yes, that's very interesting. I don't know if I let you know what. Let me. It would be great if I can put it on.
Yeah, sure. You can. So if you double tap the screen, you can show us the your laptop screen if there's something that you want to show there.
Okay, just a moment. Let me just see if I can. Yeah, that's it. So you can, I've just typed the website, www.oifnigeria.org. And then on Instagram, did you get that?
Ah, yeah. Great, I've got it, yeah.
Yeah, Instagram, let me see, I did write it out somewhere. So our website is actually got all the information. So okay, if anybody just goes on our website, they will be able to link straight away through the website to go down to the Instagram page and then our Facebook page. So it's
perfect.
But I'm going to just text it on the, you know, as we're speaking, I'll text it.
Perfect. And within the community in Nigeria, is there a particular building or somewhere that people can find you, or the OIF Foundation, or is there a number? Is that all on the website already?
All is on the website. Yeah.
Great. Okay. So if any of you have someone that you know is dealing with OI, or you would like some extra information, and even if you maybe aren't from Nigeria, but you're in the surrounding areas, perhaps you'll be able to kind of direct them into the right place. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, great. Yeah. So what are your short-term and long-term goals for OFIN?
Well, yeah, that's a very interesting one. Yeah, I will start off with the short term. One, to keep going, to keep supporting people with a disability. Secondly, we are also, you know, to be able to support our children to have surgery. Now we have a lot of quite a few children that are ready for surgery, and we just want to get that, you know, to happen for them. A lot of them break a lot, and so we are looking to support them to get surgery to correct. The surgery will help to correct the long bones.
Yes.
The deformity in the long bones, whereby a brush pin is being inserted into the long bones to help straighten.
I'll give a demonstration. So my arm is completely curved here. This is how it was broken. And when I was younger, I had rods, this probably wouldn't have happened. Mm. But because I didn't get the support I needed at the time in order to get the surgery, it means that I'm kind of left with a deformed arm as such. Yes. The same with my leg. I did show that yesterday, deformities are on all of my long bones. So, there's another OI in the chat today. And she's also an activist.
Yeah.
Yes. And she says that she's dealing with the same thing as me. We have the same arm. We're twins. Okay. And your long-term goal is what? What are you hoping for long-term?
Ooh, long-term goal. That's very interesting. Stephen, mm-hmm. What do you think our long-term goal is? Maybe you want to chip in something there?
I'm not very sure.
Don't be shy, Stephen. You've got this.
Long-term goals. Well, I think your long-term goals is still just to get people going, really.
Well, he said it
having,
all.
And having, making the kids and everyone else have operations.
Yeah. Well, our long-term goal is to be there for a long time to support children and families with disability. There is a lot to do in the foundation. Yeah. Because of where, you know, where people are, because of their beliefs, because of what they are understanding. You know, Nigeria has really got a long way to go. There is the stigmatization we are facing. There is the beliefs of the people that we are facing. There is the, you know, neglect that people are really facing. So we would love to, you know, be able to tackle all that and still keep the child, you know, mentally stable, emotionally stable, and also still keep the family intact.
So can I suggest that part of the planning has been, we were going to plan something, weren't we? We were going to have an event that I was going to come to and perform possibly in the future and try my best to mentor other people in Nigeria.
Yes.
And advocate for them. I get messages all the time. I get lots of DMs about, oh, I'm lonely in Nigeria. I'm by myself. I don't feel confident, and so on and so forth. So for me as well with OIF Nigeria is for me to sort of join long term and really, I guess it will be my main focus whenever I get to where I want to be, in order for, you know, this stigma to be over, because it's not just with OI, it's with disabilities in general, but especially with OI, and it causes us not to have the correct information, I suppose. So with that, how that kind of goes on to the next question of how has COVID-19 affected OIF Nigeria, and have you changed any of your services since the COVID-19 to accommodate for to the users?
Yes, we have. Actually, COVID-19 is not just affecting people with OI, is affecting the whole world. So we are really, you know, everybody has been forced to do things differently, and it has also forced OIF Nigeria to actually, you know, think ahead, think fast, and forced us to do things differently. I'll just quickly talk a little about what we've done during the COVID-19 and how we've done it in this period of COVID-19. OIF Nigeria, we were able to support not just our members, not just our volunteers. So we've supported even the public, you know, to create and raise awareness on the situation of COVID-19 and what COVID-19 really is. We have educated our members and even the public so that they can understand what it is. You know what Nigeria is. You know, if you do not stress on things, make them understand, they don't see the risk of keeping themselves safe and how to keep themselves safe. So we've actually just, you know, what we've done is to educate people on that, especially our members, and then we've held meetings. Our meetings, we've held them differently, where we've had to like adapt to hold more meetings on WhatsApp and on online generally, you know, where we just educate them the importance of keeping safe, and why they need to keep safe. And, you know, as a patient of OI, or as a, you know, as a person living with brittle bone condition, what are your risks? We need to make them understand, help them to understand the risk that they have, if, you know, how vulnerable they can also be to being affected by the COVID-19. So, you know, we have to teach them how to keep themselves safe, how, you know, just, and then obey the government guidelines. And also what we've done in the past, during this COVID-19, over the past few weeks, we've actually supported families with call credits to be able to, we supported about 105 individuals with call credits. to so not just the OI community, but also other disability, yes. Because we are also working with other disabled
organizations.
So we, you know, to help them stay connected with their external bodies, and to help them stay connected with their medical practitioners. So, you know, if they don't,
that's useful to know, because as I said to you before, I've got like about 3 or 4 people in Nigeria at the moment who are very scared. They don't really know what their risk is, and I've seen them outside.
Yeah. Oh, that's very dangerous.
Queuing up and all sorts of things in their wheelchairs. So, you know, it's useful now. Now I know that you guys can kind of help with that, or lead them the right way in terms of other organizations that may be able to support them. Yes. So, Stephen, I saw you singing recently. Was that part of, you know, trying to uplift the spirits of people who are currently, you know, in their homes?
Well, you could say that. I was just really doing it for fun, I guess. I just like doing things. But,
well, that's Stephen for you. Stephen is
it.
You can never touch him in a you know, to be down in spirit. Mm-hmm. Stephen is always very infectious with his laughter, with his smile. And when I, you know, just what we, the video you saw online yesterday, I only thought about it 2 days ago. And I said, look, great for us to have a go at this. You know, I know we're in a lockdown. One is to keep the family together, to bond us together, through song, and then just have some fun. And at the same time, we, you know, just, you know, do something out there that we can give to the OI community and even people that don't have OI. And, you know, they can just do it, have fun, and just get uplifted and, you know, dance for a while and just enjoy themselves. Yes. And at the same time, we are raising awareness, on breast-to-bone condition.
Perfect. And I love doing that, Stephen. I love to sort of have fun with it, because I'm a very giggly and fun person. I like to dance and... Unfortunately, right now, I'm unable to dance, but I will listen to, you know, a little bit of music and jam a little bit with along to some good music. But yeah, it definitely uplifted a lot of my followers, you know, spirits yesterday. They are so excited to meet you. I know some people will be coming along about 8:30, and we have roughly about 3 or 4 more questions to go. And some of them are actually for you, Stephen. Yeah, so. If anyone in the comments wants to ask Stephen or Torella any questions, please feel free to do so, because, you know, I'm sure they're willing to help, as long as it's respectful and it's fun and enjoyable. So my next question to you was...
Before we go to your next question, if I just got you there. Sure. I think... it's important for me to stress the work that OIF Nigeria is doing, especially at this time of COVID-19. Like as I said before, we supported people with, you know, with call cards and all that. But, you know, I think it is very, we need to understand that the disability world is completely different. You know, people need to understand that. And the way to do things, we really do need to think and make sure we are doing things properly, in a manner and in a way that it is beneficiary to the people that have got disability, and in a way that is safe for them. One of the things we did, not just sending the call cards into their phone so they can sit in their house and then receive the call credit. And what we did was also to the beneficiaries that we had to, we sent into the straight directly into the accounts. We gave them 5,000 naira. And if you add that to, I think we didn't do that with much people. We just had to, you know, limit our doings to the according to her, you know, our ability, the funds that we have. So we were able to support about 20 to 30 people, just around that figure, with 5,000 naira. So where it, the money was paid directly into their accounts, and then at their own convenience, they can actually take their bank cards, go to the shopping mall where it is safe for them, and how to, you know, in a place where it is safe for them to really shop. So they don't need to, you know, I didn't really like the idea of where people are crowded together, and then you see a woman that is carrying a child that is very, very vulnerable and easy to break a bone, and, you know, rushing for food, or, you know, doing all that. I just felt they needed we needed to respect their dignity. We needed to respect who they are, and, you know, try and do things in a very safe environment and in a safe way for them.
I thank you for explaining that, because it is very important to be clear on that these people are at risk. A lot of disabled people right now, currently around the world, are at risk, and we are people say, oh, well, we're vulnerable. What does vulnerable really mean? Because they haven't directly said disabled, or those with physical needs or mental needs. And so that becomes a problem, because people like us fall through the cracks, and, you know, people begin to make decisions that are possibly not the correct decision at that time in order to be safe for yourself and for your child. And as I said, one of my friends, a very dear friend to me, she wants to be successful, and she lives in Nigeria. She's a model, and she's explained to me, you know, she has to go outside, and I believe there must be somebody that will be willing to help her in a dignifiable way, whereby she still has her independence, but in a safe way in this current climate.
Exactly.
You know? So we can always go back to that question, because it's, you know, it's something that is ongoing. And also, guys, if you enjoy this live and you would like to hear from Tarela and Stephen again, and we could definitely have this conversation again, and maybe an update within the next maybe 2 or 3 months or so, because as we know, this COVID-19 is developing in so many different ways, and governments are making so many different decisions for people of all ages and all abilities. So what's the most helpful information you can give my audience about OI? Do you feel, maybe Stephen, do you feel like there's something that you want to add to the young people that might have OI, or disabled people that might have a different condition of some kind? Is there anything encouraging you want to give them, or?
I'm thinking.
What would you like to say to them?
Come back to you.
Well, I guess what I would say to them is, I'm trying to think. It's kind of a bit hard
for
me.
No rush.
I'm a bit of a jolly person.
It's all good. It's all good. Listen, we're all learning.
Is that question to Stephen alone, or you wanted me to?
No. Okay. Yes, you can answer, Tarela. I don't mind.
Yeah. Well, I think I will say, you know, people, before people see you, they see disability. So I would say disability doesn't define you, you know, and you are who you are, and you need to keep strong. Even for people that don't have any disability, the world is still, they still struggle with, you know, with things, and the world still struggles with them. So you have to keep strong. You have to keep, you know, pushing, just a little push, extra push. You can achieve a lot. You can do whatever you want to do. You can, you know, the sky is the limit. This, for me, people say the sky is the limit, but for me, I say the sky is the beginning. So you can
push boundaries. I like that.
And, you know, push beyond the sky, and you get to your goals. You know, so don't let disability hold you down, because it's not supposed to. And just be strong and push a little. You can achieve it. So you can do it.
That's very, very encouraging words, even for me. Thank you. That's really lovely, because I think we as human beings, you know, we have so many things going on in our lives, whatever age you are. And we, you know, that those words that you just gave were so encouraging. It's very true. I like that. So the sky is the beginning.
It's the beginning.
The limit. It's the beginning.
Exactly.
Love that. I love that. I absolutely love that. Yeah, exactly. It's not your disability that holds you down.
Exactly. It's all about the mind. If you have it in your mind, exactly. You can push through and then go further. Yeah.
Yes. You can watch back Sky Savage. Just I will save this, and it will be on some other platforms as well. So even if you've missed majority of it, it will be saved, so it's fine, don't worry too much. Is there anything you wish people could consider and could take into consideration for this community that we haven't mentioned before? If there's nothing, then it's fine.
Well, it depends. What I said is it depends. Is we're talking about Nigeria, or we're talking about what to consider here in the UK?
I would say Nigeria. Let's start with Nigeria, because that's
exactly.
Where
it's two different worlds. Exactly. Yeah. It's two different worlds. And from my experience,
two roaming... different kettle of fish.
Exactly.
Apples so, and oranges.
Yes. From my experience of running OIF in Nigeria is you have to tackle things differently, from the way things are being done here in the UK. You know, one of the things that we have to tackle with is apart from the beliefs of people is a lot of brainwashing is going on. We deal with a lot of gender issue.
Mm.
Yeah, for the fact that you're a woman, you can't even come out to really speak to another male counterpart that is doing the same thing as you. So you have to deal with all that. And if a woman has a child that has got brittle bone condition, I remember a case where because one of the things that I do is I attend a lot of doctor conference in Nigeria, so yes. I raise awareness among them, and so that just in case they come in contact with children that have got brittle bone condition, then we can intervene quickly by mm-hmm. providing the right advice, the right care, and then the right medication for the child, and also support the family. And so one of the doctors called me at the time the child was being born. I think few days after the child was born, I think about 3 days. And she said to me, a child is being born in my hospital, and she will want me to talk to the mother of the child. Then I said to her, okay, that's not a problem. Have you got the medication? Do we need to send medication for, pay for the medication? Because nothing is free in Nigeria. You really have to pay for those medication, and they don't come cheap. Yeah, they're about 20,000 naira, which is about 80 pounds. So, or so in Nigeria. So, and quickly yeah. I said, you want me to speak to the mom? What's going on? And she said to me, the doctor said to me, you need to be very, very careful, because it seemed like the father is abandoned the mother and the child in the hospital. And I said, why? Okay, I can understand maybe because the child is coming. He said because the child is coming with a lot of deformity and the bones are broken and all that stuff. So I said, what's going on? Okay, that's fine. I said, is there any other issue I need to know? Any other thing I need to know before I speak to the mother? And I said, what is the sex of the child? She said to me, he's a female. And that's another issue. So the father stumbled out of the hospital, not wanting to have anything to do with the child, because there is this idea that when a child is perfect, it's for the father. And when there's something wrong with the child, it's for the mother. And when you have a female child, that's something then is wrong with, not that anything is wrong with a child with brittle bone, but, you know, that's the context, that's the way they see it in Nigeria.
Yeah.
So then it's double, in Nigeria they say double wahala for the woman. Mm.
Yes.
So it was double trouble for the woman. So the yes. father actually abandoned the child and the woman in the hospital. So after yes. speaking with the woman, she was really in a lot of tears, and, you know, I had to really encourage her, and I promised to speak to the husband if he would speak to me. But I knew that there probably might be an issue. The man might not want to talk to me, because it's very obvious, I'm a woman. So, you know, and in Nigeria, they look at you as a woman, a second
why
class.
Why? What for? What's the meaning?
Yes. So it seems like you've had the experience before.
Ah, wow. Sister, headache upon headache. The fact that I'm a girl,
you.
Plus
yeah.
I live on my own, plus I have osteogenesis. Ah, it's a headache.
Exactly. It is a big one. A big one. So yeah, so I had to intervene in that to, you know, speak to the, finally spoke to the man, and I was able, you know, after much prayers though, before I went to speak to him, I was able to, you know, still convince him and educate him on what OI is and the condition and all that. But anyway, at the end of the day, you know, he reconciled with the wife and, you know, hoping to take the child home. But unfortunately, the child died before medication could get to the child, before they could start any treatment at all. I think about a few days later, I think about a few days after I'd spoken to them, the child died. Oh. That was very
so which happens sometimes because of our condition is very severe.
Because of our condition, because of our culture.
Yeah.
You know, the thing is, even the children, I'm sure they can, in some way or another, they can actually feel the tension between them, you know, when they are not loved, when they don't feel that, you know, that connection there. So those are the issues that affect we, you know, back home.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the issue is a lot. So the way we tackle this, we tackle issues back home in Nigeria is completely different from here. That was the reason why I asked you if it was in Nigeria or here. So,
I think we'll leave it at Nigeria because at the end of the day, that's what the main point of this live is, if I'm honest. I think that, you know, there is already a Brittle Bone Society for the UK. So if you do want to find out more information from them, you're more than welcome. But, you know, as we said at the beginning of this live, is that, you know, it's very different when it comes to culture, when it comes to there's so many layers, like what Terela just explained about the fact that the, you know, disabled people, if you're a man or a woman, if you're female or male, and then on top of the mum and how the mum's treated, it's a lot of layers that can affect that child's future, essentially.
Absolutely.
And yeah, so okay, so I want to know, what's the hardest thing you've faced? I guess you've kind of explained it, to be honest, the hardest thing you faced when it comes to OIF Nigeria, and that is probably the cultural aspect of trying to establish, an understanding amongst the families, I suppose. So it's not even setting up the actual foundation. Tell me, let me know if I'm wrong by what I'm sort of saying.
Sorry, Toby, come again. Sorry, I just drifted there.
Oh, okay. No, I was just saying that the hardest thing that you've faced with OIF in Nigeria.
Okay, yeah. Well, like
I said, one question. I'll go back to it in a second.
Yeah. Like as I said before, is the issue of stigmatization, and also this gender thing. You know, you cannot. My son is laughing. Yeah, the gender thing is a big issue in Nigeria, especially where female children are not really very accepted. And you know, you as a female child, as a female, you're doing this or running an organization is a bit difficult. So it's like you really have to push hard, be on top of him, and really, you know what you're doing, and you really have to push extra hard, you know, to get there, to, you know, communicate your heart, you know, to the public and to the people. And also, you know, I've had experiences where, you know, I'm about to, you know, speak to somebody, for the fact that the person is the fact that the person that I'm about to speak to, lay my complaints to, all, you know, issues to, is a male, I'm asked to go get a male representative, even though I'm the founder of the organization. Wow. Yeah, I've had to deal with that. And also another major issue that, you know, that I've found, issue that I found so difficult, that has really stared me on the face, is this the stigmatization, and also the belief, the culture. The culture is one serious thing that we have to really push into. I'll give you an example. In Nigeria, in Africa as a whole, but you know, I will speak for Nigeria because I'm very much conversant with the culture in Nigeria. When you have with Britable, a child, when you give birth, there is this traditional thing that is being done. The mother-in-law or the mother of the woman comes to live with the family, and will have to help. I think in Nigeria it's called Omugwo. In the Igbo's side, it's called Omugwo, and they will have to help with, you know, taking care of the child, and also taking care of the mother, cooking for the mother, and bathing the child, and all that. So one you know, heavy culture that happens in Nigeria is, while the baby is being cared for, there is this serious pulling of the hands and pulling of the legs, and you know,
and turning the baby. It's a massage that they do
with heavy pressure, with heavy pressure, and you know, they have to turn the baby upside down, pull the hand seriously like that, jig the baby here and there. Chiku the baby here and there, and also, you know, the hands and all that, and the legs and that. And they tell you it's a tradition. If you ask them why they do it, they can't really explain the reason why, and they just tell you, oh, it will help the baby strong. I have a video on that. In fact, I'm doing a lot of research into that. And
they tell, I don't know if you're aware, they also do it in India. I found a video on it as well.
I'm not surprised.
The baby upside down in India too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So those are, if the baby is a child that has got OI, how do you do that with that child? You know?
Oh, no. It's giving me a countdown because we've been on here for an hour. So really? Let me quickly round up before it cuts me off. So we've already said, okay, what is your favorite memory within this organization? Is there a particular memory that you had within OIF Nigeria that has made you, and then I'm going to ask Stephen as well, what his favorite memory is as well. So let's start with
this. I think bonding the parents, the you know, the families back together, putting, you know, helping them to understand what the condition is, and we are able to then unite the families. Because there was another case that we went through, and the father stumbled out again and left the parents, but I was able to still speak to him, and he went back, and I was able to support financially, you know.
And then quickly, Stephen, before it cuts off, what's your favorite memory so far with this organization?
the thing is about that is, if I've been